Brad Jungwirth.
Jungwirth.
It looks very European. It looks like it should be a Y.
Well, it should be. It's like there have been a few like well-known opera singers in Germany with the same surname. But technically, it's Jungwirth. I like to split the pretension and just do Jungwirth.
Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us.
Of course.
Please tell us, Brad, where are you from?
I grew up in Rochester, Minnesota, home of the Mayo Clinic. And I still live in Chicago. I've lived in Chicago for like 20 years.
And how old were you when you started studying music?
I think I started to kind of like teach myself the piano when I was around like 8. And then by around 10, I started playing the violin and taking violin. Actually, I started on viola. But then after a year, I switched to violin because I wanted more glamour. I wanted the melody. And then was really a serious violinist, took some piano lessons. I was 17. I was a junior in high school when I first started taking voice lessons. And it was just because I had gotten involved in theater at high school and I was cast in a role in a musical that while the directors knew that I was a good musician, I wasn't necessarily the best singer. So after being cast, they're like, here's a voice teacher. You need to have some lessons if you're actually going to be able to sing this. So I kind of dutifully like did it just to, you know, prep for that. But I kept doing it through the rest of high school. And my teacher was very, very technical, pretty serious. I wasn't serious. I was a serious violinist, but I wouldn't really practice singing. And then I even started college as a violin major. And then halfway through, the voice department had heard me singing and I was taking lessons and they encouraged me to switch. So I had been studying music for a long time. Singing, I was late teens. There's really little point in doing a lot of serious study when you're too young as a singer. One of the best things in my case and for most singers is if you learn to play an instrument or at least play the piano before you start studying, because it gives you some sort of tangible outward representation of music. Because as I'll talk about later, like being a singer a lot, it's very internal. I'm very lucky that I was able to play some instruments first.
So it's a maturity. Does it have to do with the development of the voice and all of those things that actually singers peak later in their careers?
That is true to some extent. I'd say as a broad statement, it's true. It really depends on the actual voice. You know, there's a whole wide array of specific voice types. Generally, the smaller or lighter a voice, the earlier it matures. So like a light little fluttery soprano could very well be in their prime at like 25. Male voices take a little bit longer. If you're a big Wagnerian soprano, your voice won't really be at its peak until you're like mid-30s, 40. Baritones and basses, it's, you know, 30s and 40s. A bass, you know, even sometimes in the 50s is like prime. So what we have to remember is that the voice is not just an instrument, it's a living organism. So it is going to be very, very unique to each person, and it's going to be subject to a whole myriad of conditions that affect it. So, yeah, it's generally a little bit older, but before you know it, you're too old.
Where did you go to study? You went for violin. Where did you go? What
school? I went to the Chicago College of the Performing Arts, which is at Roosevelt University in Chicago. And the reason I went there is they had, at the time, what was kind of an innovative and rare program where you could actually major in orchestral studies, like a performance major, but focused on orchestral literature, and you were working with Chicago Symphony members. So never wanting to be like a big solo violinist, I wanted to play in an orchestra. That's what drew me to the school. And, you know, their voice program is good. They had some good teachers. I had some great teachers. I got to work with some very like legendary singers. But I went there because of the orchestral program, and then I was just lazy and stayed. And then I decided it was good enough that I went back for my master's a few years later. Because I liked the teacher I had started studying with, and he was on faculty there. And, you know, at least it was familiar. And I wanted to be in a city, so I thought, what the heck, I'll just stay here.
So did you finish your violin degree, or did you actually switch and graduate with a voice degree, or did you do both?
I switched the middle of my sophomore year. I had enough coursework, though, that I have a minor in violin performance. And then the major was vocal. And then my master's is in vocal performance and pedagogy, which is, you know, the science and the study of the voice.
And was that a hard decision to make, to leave the violin? Or was it a big decision? Was it a difficult decision switching courses like that?
You know, it wasn't difficult for me because, you know, I had started taking voice at college when I was still a freshman. Because after a semester of like being around singers for the first time, I was like, oh, maybe I kind of like this more than I thought. And I'd always been told that, you know, I had a lot of promise as a singer. I had a good instrument. I just didn't really, when I was younger, care about it. But being around more singers, the competitive nature kicked in. And I was like, well, I'm not really any worse than some of these people. So I started taking voice. I still had to do like juries, even though I wasn't a major. And the voice faculty, like at my first jury, they were like, why aren't you a voice major? And then the next semester, I even like auditioned for one of the operas and I got cast, and some voice majors didn't get cast. I mean, I had a tiny part. I had like four lines. And even after the audition, one of the pianists who was on faculty, she whispered to me, she's like, aren't you a violin major? You should be a singer. So there was, part of it was just the like, ooh, I'm getting praise. I'm getting recognized. So it wasn't hard for me. I felt guilt a little bit in terms of my parents. They felt they were a little suspicious at first because it's like, oh my God, you've played the violin for so long. We've invested all this time and money. So getting them to realize that it wasn't a complete like 180. It was still helping the same path. And they came around and it certainly has helped me. So I wasn't too terribly conflicted. I really think of it as when I look at like the trajectory of my life and my interests, it seems like the most logical conclusion that I would be a singer. Because I've always, you know, since a young age, loved music. My parents are not particularly musical. I just kind of discovered classical music and such largely on my own. I'd always loved languages. If I hadn't majored in voice, I either would have majored in linguistics or psychology. Loved literature, loved like analyzing literature. I loved theater and acting. So when you add those all up, music, being on stage, foreign languages, analyzing text, it just seems like the big, oh, yeah, I should be a singer. So it wasn't that hard for me.
And so when was it that you decided that you were going to do it professionally and that you wanted to make your living as a singer?
This is a real basic way of saying it, but I think most of you understand kind of like when I was majoring in it. You know, when I changed my major to voice, it's like, okay, like I want to be a singer for my life, because we know it's not quite that easy, but I was of the mindset, well, this is my major, so this is what I'm going to do with my life. I pretty much made that commitment when I got my degree. And it wasn't like begrudgingly, it was, okay, this is what I want to do. This is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Because you had started university as a violin major, you had already sort of made the decision that you wanted to be a professional in the music industry already, right?
Yes.
And that happened in high school?
Yeah. I would say really by like midway through high school, I knew that I wanted to get a degree in music. Like, you know, I didn't want to take like calculus and stuff when I was a senior in high school, because I knew I was going to go to some conservatory program. If I was going to study music, I didn't want some like nice like liberal arts program. Like I wanted to study music. So, and academics always came easily to me, except I didn't like math. So I don't think of it as I was a music major, so I didn't have to do academic classes, but it was just like, I'm getting a good, well-rounded education. I'm intelligent. I'm well-rounded. I want to really, really focus solely on music. And I did. I love the conservatory program because, you know, with the exception of just a couple of outside classes, like an English class, but, you know, AP testing took care of some of those classes. I was taking all music classes. When you're a singer, when you're a voice major, you're also taking a couple years of like foreign languages. So like those electives, so to speak, are already kind of built in, but I was always all for that. So I really enjoyed that I could just focus on things that related to what I wanted to do and not have to take an, you know, economics class or a biology class. Like, I knew I wouldn't need it.
And so what languages have you studied?
I studied German all through high school. I studied there for a summer. Like, when I was younger, like, I was not quite fluent, but certainly conversant. And then I had to take a year of French, a year of Italian. It's, you don't have to really know a language to sing in it. It helps. And if you're going to be singing so much in foreign languages, it's good to know some of the grammar and recognize conjugated verbs. So I've studied those. I've sung in Czech. I've sung in Russian. With the help of phonetics, I have sung in, like, you know, strange Chinese dialects. A couple of pieces in Polish. But I certainly haven't, like, studied Russian or Czech. It's just, you know, some personal study and then working with a good coach who actually knows the language. But Italian, French, and German, I could certainly find my way around. I can go to a restaurant, I can get a taxi cab, I can tell the conductor the tempo is too fast. You know, I can say those kind of basic things if I need to.
So do you have, as a vocalist, sort of dialect coaches like actors have? Is it sort of the same concept?
If you look into, like, the technical aspects of what, like, a dialect coach would do, yeah, to some extent. Singers get diction training, and that's a little bit different. It's more about comprehension of how to pronounce a certain language. It's usually using the IPA, the International Phonetic Alphabet, which is kind of a language into itself. But a diction class is more about the accommodations and the pitfalls we have to be aware of when we're singing in a certain language. So it's a little bit different than an actual dialect coach. You know, a dialect coach would be just doing accent. Diction and singing in a foreign language, it's more than just an accent.
Well, and the natural agogic accents of the language don't necessarily come through when you put them to music, right?
Well, it depends on the composer. I feel a good composer that really has a good instinct for setting language will put the stresses of words on strong beats, higher pitches, longer rhythms, plus a lot of song literature and, you know, operatic music. The texts are, in some way, they're poetic, they're metered. So, you know, if the poet or the librettist is able to kind of get the meter of the poetry to coincide with stress syllables and important words, a good composer is going to take that even further. They do some of the work for you. It is very hard. Like, I've sung, you know, certain really contemporary pieces, and maybe the composer, it might be in English, but the composer isn't setting the words in a very idiomatic way. That's incredibly challenging, to have to put accents in different places like that. It just, it doesn't feel right. But then you look at somebody like Mozart, who, you know, was not from Italy, but the bulk of his vocal music is in Italian. You know, he clearly knew the language, and he was working with the meter of the poetry, and it just, even if you're a little unsure where the stresses are, if you just look at the music, it tells you, it gives you a pretty clear indicator. Verdi did it, Puccini did it, like, all the good vocal composers just kind of innately do that, because they understood that's how you deliver the text. If you're going against accents and this or that, it's going to make comprehension harder. We're already singing, which is like heightened speaking. So we're already one level up. If you don't have some of those stresses and stuff still intact, then the syntax and the language becomes incredibly hard to comprehend, especially with an orchestra playing too.
I suppose that those challenges are what led to people becoming professional librettists and doing jobs that work specifically putting the text to the music.
I don't know that for sure, but I'd say a lot of librettists also wrote poetry. And, you know, there are some great composers who've also written their own text or their own libretto, but they also have a knack. I mean, it's musical theater, but Stephen Sondheim writes his own lyrics and his music. Before he was a composer, he was writing crossword puzzles for the New York Times. So he clearly had an interest and a love for and an education about words. You know, you have one of Verdi's librettists, Arrigo Boito, who did the librettos for Otello, maybe a few other things. He was also a composer, so he's known for his big opera, Mephistopheles. So it's interesting, this is kind of on a tangent, but if you look at even in the 19th century and before, you can definitely tell that some of these musicians and the librettists, they were gig workers. Like they were, you know, they were doing what they can. Okay, Boito had a knack for writing librettos. Maybe he was really a composer, but he was going to take the gig and help Verdi out and presumably make some money. So that's what I think, you know, as of late, when we talk about gig working, that's what I think is very interesting, seeing how diverse some of these people were. And I think the diversity came from a sense of they just needed jobs.
So tell us a little bit about what you're doing now. I know you're singing for a church, you're doing a lot of teaching, you're doing a lot of gigging.
I used to do a little bit more performing because I would, you know, I would travel places for auditions and things like that, and like travel out of state and stuff to sing. And I still do that sometimes, usually if somebody approaches me about something. But yes, I have a large studio of high school students and I teach at Lake Forest College. One of the good side jobs for singers are to be like professional singers at a church. So that is plentiful in big cities. The church I sing at, it's a nice church. So like every Christmas they do like the Christmas portion of the Messiah with an orchestra, and you know, all the soloists are the staff members and stuff. So it's nice to still be able to sing real music, but not have to, you know, change gigs once a month or fly here and there. I get to come home. I get to come home every day. So as I've gotten older, I've just gotten a lot more judicial about what's going to take me away from my home. If I'm going to be gone for a week or two or a couple months, is it worth it?
Great. So let's go ahead and let's move into your presentation.
Okay. So I'm going to start by just talking just real basically about some aspects of vocal anatomy and such. Like, this is not going to be a comprehensive covering of vocal pedagogy. I think what this is going to show to the instrumentalists is so much of what singers have to deal with is internal. You can't see any of it. A pianist or a flutist, like, you can see what your wrist is doing. You can see where your finger is. Your teacher can help you. You know, my violin teacher would talk about like bow hold. With a singer, most of what we're dealing with cannot be seen. And it's also things that we are using, it's muscle groups that we are using all the time without thinking about it. We're breathing, we're speaking. So I think one of the challenges of singing is starting to pay attention to the things that we take for granted, that we use all of the time. It's hard to find incentive to train something when you're like, I'm breathing all the time. Why do I have to improve how I breathe? So I'm just going to go over real kind of quickly kind of the aspects technically that a singer has to deal with, okay? First of all, singers have to think about breathing. I know wind players and brass players do too, but in those cases, the actual management of the air is happening with the lips and the reed or the mouthpiece. You know, yes, they have to take some, you know, strengthen their breathing muscles to breathe deeper maybe, but they're creating air pressure with the embouchure and the reed, etc. Singers, we train ourselves to create that pressure internally. It has to happen below the vocal cords. So there's this fine balance of how are we using our body, how are we managing our air, and tension on with certain muscles in the throat and the larynx. It's finding that balance. So that in and of itself is challenging. Then we get into just being aware of, I call it like the open spaces of our instrument. The arrow here is pointing to the larynx, which we'll talk about in a second. This is just a cutaway of the skull. And while the sound starts down here in the larynx where the vocal cords are, we have all sorts of empty space above and below it, even going up into the sinuses. Can you see how there's openness up in the sinus cavities and the skull? So it almost looks like a trumpet, like you can see like the bell of a trumpet. So in addition to learning everything that musicians have to learn, singers have to start in their own way, figuring out what they can do to really make sure that that whole, all the spaciousness inside stays open. That's how we resonate. That's how we eventually learn to project over an orchestra without a microphone. So I think of the aspect of this with singing as kind of, imagine a clarinetist when they're younger, they're leaving out one of the joints of the clarinet. They have to kind of figure it out. We're gaining strength to be able to keep these areas open, to kind of maximize the flow. Just like, you know, the inside of a stringed instrument is hollow so it can resonate. We want to find that hollowness inside, and we have to work to maintain it. Most people don't maintain it daily or consistently. So there's all sorts of muscles at the roof of the mouth, the back of the throat, the tongue plays into it, that we are trying to line everything up and connect it. So really, if we go back to that clarinetist idea, a young singer is kind of the equivalent of the teacher gives the young clarinetist the pieces of the clarinet, and then maybe in the dark is making them put in together. And maybe they can't physically even use one of the joints yet. So it's frustrating to have to train muscles to kind of find all of the resonant space that you've got inside your for your instrument. So there's a lot of stuff to worry about there. On a real basic level, if all of you just like clench your teeth together and say, E, say it. You can just hear how that, you can hear how it's a real tight, kind of contained sound. E, we work to open stuff up so we can just make more sounds with more ease, okay? So that's just kind of in a nutshell, you know, people, we're thinking about keeping this area that I'm circling open. It's the same feeling you'd have if you were like sniffing in. So it's training all of these muscles to keep working. Like I said earlier, the body just instinctually will do these things in a very fleeting way. But it's maintaining that subtle muscular activity for a very long period of time. We're gonna zero in now on the larynx. This is a drawing of the larynx, which is kind of, you could argue, like the epicenter of where singing is. This is where the actual pitches take place. The larynx is a chunk of cartilage that sits on top of the airway. And there are muscles on the outside of it, there are cartilages, and then inside are the vocal cords or the vocal folds. We'll come back to that in a second. So another thing that singers, especially trained singers, really strive to deal with is finding stability in the larynx. And that involves a whole bunch of things, and it takes a while. We're trying to find stability, but also adjustment in these muscles here. These release the larynx, they kind of let it, we would say, tilt, and that allows the cords then to keep thinning to make higher pitches. So we're also really kind of monitoring and training ourselves to be consistent with our larynx, but some of the consistency comes from adjustment. I don't know if that makes sense. So this is where we are making the pitches. This is where it all begins. And this is probably like the trickiest area for a singer to kind of target. The teacher is going by just knowledge and what they hear and instinct. There aren't a lot of visual clues. And a good singer needs to have a lot of self-awareness in terms of what do I feel going on inside my body? We can't see it, so we have to go by feeling. And a lot of these muscles, like, you know, cricothyroids and whatnot, we don't pay attention to them. So sometimes it can take years for a young singer to start having the self-awareness of just sensing what's going on inside. And then you can start to train it further, okay? So there's a lot with the larynx to kind of worry about. And then, where it all starts, these are the vocal folds. And they are just tiny little band of tissue right there that whenever we phonate, which is the fancy term for speaking, singing, making any sort of sound, there are muscles that bring those chords together, just like if you think of an oboe or a bassoon reed. It's that double reed idea. They come together, and then air from below passes through them and causes them to vibrate. So I think of the voice as a very, very odd hybrid of a wind instrument and a string instrument, because the actual sound is made in kind of that reed-like way, where these two bands of tissue are brought together, there is pressurized air underneath, and it steadily vibrates the chords. We change pitch, though, on a stretch principle, which is most similar to a stringed instrument. You know, when you tune a violin peg and the string stretches, it goes higher in pitch. So we also have muscles attached to the vocal cords that stretch, tense them, or relax them and make them thicker. And that's what allows us to respectively sing higher, sing lower. Now, those are muscles. Those are tiny little muscles that do that. So this is another area where singers, it takes time. I have students that come to me and they're like, I want to be able to sing high. Well, it doesn't work that way. I'd love to be able to bench press 250 pounds, but you don't start with 250 pounds. You start with 10. So it's slowly but surely strengthening and coordinating those muscle groups, balancing them with what we are doing with our air and how we're managing and pressurizing the air, and also trying to maintain, you know, the openness inside, staying out of the way so we can resonate. So we are juggling multiple things before we even get into communication as a singer and acting and stuff. We are literally like putting our instrument together as we do it, as we sing. Eventually it becomes easier, but you know, I can't think of really any other instrument where you have to start using the instrument in such a rough, unrefined form. You know, that young clarinetist may not have a great clarinet, but their teacher shows them how to put it together, and they're at least given the opportunity. They are given instrumentally, like, full opportunity to make a great sound. A pianist, you know, if it's in tune and it's a decent piano, they can sit down and start playing things accurately. They may not be playing Chopin right away, but they can play, you know, Hot Cross Buns or Twinkle Twinkle. The voice doesn't work that way. We are literally trying to like make our instruments as we train it. We have so many more things to worry about. So being an instrumentalist first, I'm usually, you know, regarded as a better musician than your stereotypical singer. The instrumental training helps, but I think singers get a little bit of a bad reputation for being dumb or bad musicians because we have to think about so many things. If I'm on the operatic stage, not only have I trained my body to do all of these things and basically do them of their own free will, so in performance I don't have to think too much about it. And that, you know, that's echoed in all the other instruments, muscle memory. But then we're also dealing with singing from memory, projecting, managing a costume or a hat, staying in your light, looking at a conductor. We're singing in a foreign language. We have to know what we're saying. We have to know what it means. We have to deal with our co-stars. So we have so many things to deal with. And then you add into it, even more than other instruments, we are so malleable and changeable. You know, allergies will affect things. You know, if you're a little phlegmy or gunky or have a little cold, a good singer, we can still sing through it, but you're a little bit more on guard. You have to think about it. I mean, imagine if a pianist has a cold, maybe their focus and their energy level is a little, but they can play fine. Imagine playing if you had phlegm all over the keyboard. You know, or, you know, if you're playing a trumpet and you've got like gunk on your fingers, it's going to affect how you hit the valves. Singers deal with that all the time. And it's directly on our instrument. And then you add in, you know, the psychology of it, the emotions, which will affect all musicians, but sorry to say, when our body really is the instrument and not just our hands manipulating an instrument, it can be severely affected. So we have a lot to worry about. This is just skimming the surface of pedagogical concepts. It's true, as a singer, you can never put your instrument down. I'm not too fussy of a singer. I don't have a lot of rituals. I don't steam my voice. I'm not wearing scarves all the time. I believe to each their own. But I get why, you know, if you think of the stereotypical image of the singer with scarves wrapped around their neck and like hot tea and everything, I get it. It's because you are always carrying your instrument and you're always using it. Even if you're just speaking or whatnot, you are always using it. So we can be a little bit of a head case because, I mean, imagine if, you know, you were carrying your violin with you all the time. You would be real careful about going outside in certain kinds of weather, where you were, you would be careful of those things. So that's the reason why we're all a little crazy. Keeps life interesting. Now, that'll be the end of, you know, vocal anatomy. I want us to look at a little video of actually seeing the vocal cords at work.
So this is a scope of the vocal folds. So they put a camera down someone's throat and the doctor's having him sing. This is something that, you know, a laryngologist would do. So if a singer maybe is worried they have nodes or vocal damage, they'll get scoped. I think it's just interesting to see the cords at work. It's these just gross little bands of tissue that can make some of the most glorious sounds in the world. Those cords are vibrating so fast that we really can't even see all of the vibrations with the naked eye. Some scopes use a strobe light so you can see it. But, you know, just like, you know, when the oboe is playing the A to tune the orchestra, it's vibrating at 440 hertz. The vocal folds, if a soprano is singing that same pitch, those vocal folds are vibrating the same number of times per second. So it's such tiny, fast motion. So let's just watch this a little bit.
Good. Okay, now don't swallow. Go ahead and say E. Higher pitch. Inhalation. Good. And just okay, start low and go high for me. How about a one fluid note, low to high?
So hopefully you could see how a little bit of the function of how the chords were working. I mean, and you could even see there was phlegm down there. I mean, it's this gross little bit of human anatomy that a lot of what it does is just instinct. It's doing what it's meant to do, and then it's refining it. I think of learning to sing like the idea of running. I don't particularly like running, but it's something that everyone can do. But if you're going to run a marathon, you really need to like train and condition and refine. You have to think about being efficient. You have to coordinate muscle groups. That's what real serious singing is like. And that's where I think singing, it's kind of the redheaded stepchild of music, because a lot of people are like, oh, everyone can sing. Well, yes and no, everyone can sing, but if you're going to literally use your voice as well as you possibly can, it takes that kind of training for a marathon, dedication and refinement. because it's a lot more than just opening your mouth and going, la, 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 if only it was that easy. We're going to talk a little bit now about just different voice types. I mentioned you, Alex had asked earlier about, vocal maturity. And like I said, it kind of depends on the voice. So we're going to kind of just gently break down the different kind of voice types. So most people kind of know the choral, the standard kind of chorus voices. So soprano, alto, tenor, bass, and then this one even adds baritone. Those are real basic, and again, those kind of encompass the average ranges for choral music. We have all of the choral ranges, but in terms of solo singing, there are far more kind of niche categories, even more than what are listed here. So please, if anyone sings in a choir, if you're an alto, you may not actually be an alto. If you're a bass, like I sing bass in choral music, but I'm definitely a baritone, I'm not really a bass. So I'm just saying, in general, please don't use your choral voice range to explain your voice. I had a friend in college who was, he was a little green. And, you know, in high school choir, he was always like the low bass, like second bass, bass two. So people would ask him, oh, what kind of voice type are you? I'm a bass two. And I would just be like, that's not a real voice category. With solo voices, this is where it gets a little more interesting. It has treble here. That's just kind of an unchanged boy or girl voice. And then we have soprano. We have mezzo sopranos. We have contralto. So those are the three females, contralto being the lowest and quite rare, soprano being the highest, mezzo soprano somewhere in between. And that's a more modern vocal category. A lot of music that's assigned to mezzo-sopranos now that was written in like the 1700s, 1800s. It was simply written for soprano, but you know, we can look at the history and kind of see the ranges of who these pieces were written for, and that's let us evolve into kind of the more modern mezzo-soprano. And that's just a female voice that's in between. Usually it's more like a soprano, but it just has a richer, darker color. And we'll listen to some examples in a minute. So those are the female voices. And then we have a countertenor, which is a man singing in a cultivated falsetto, which has become in fashion for the past couple of decades in an attempt to recreate what the castrati may have sounded like, the castrato singers of the 16th, 17th centuries, 18th centuries. So while it's not quite the same thing, it's training the falsetto to kind of make that more stereotypically feminine sound. And again, that's to kind of emulate the castratos. They tend to sing a lot more early music like Handel and Bach. But as you'll see in the example I play, there are definitely some modern composers that have used countertenors to good effect. Then we have tenors, baritones, and basses. Basses are, of course, the lowest. Tenors are the highest male voice, besides countertenors. And then baritones, like me, are somewhere in between. Kind of like the mezzo-soprano, baritone didn't always exist as a range. Like composers weren't, like Mozart wasn't writing stuff for baritone. He would simply say bass. But we can go back and look at certain roles he wrote for like the same singer, and we can be like, they were a baritone because he was writing it higher. They clearly could sing higher than the average bass of the time would. You can even see on this chart that ranges are also kind of negotiable. Not every voice type has the same range. It's not as cut and dry as, you know, a piano keyboard. You have access to all of those pitches. Not every singer is going to have access to the same pitches. I said that they get even more detailed than this. If we look at what are called the voice fachs, F-A-C-H, and that's the German word for just category, we have so many different subsets of many of these categories. A real singer might on the surface be a soprano, but they have so many more like niches that their voice might fall into. They might be a soubrette, which is usually like a lighter kind of more youthful sound. They might be a coloratura soprano. They specialize in singing, you know, extremely high stuff, a lot of virtuosity. They might be a lyric soprano. Think more like Mozart and Puccini, you know, they're singing longer lines. They might be a lyric coloratura, which is in between. They might be a dramatic soprano, which is the ones that sing Wagner and Strauss. Baritones, we have lyric baritones, we have dramatic baritones. We'll even use the term Verdi baritone, and that's the kind of baritone voice. That's the kind of where I fall. That's the kind of slightly bigger baritone voice that has a little more thrust, and it usually excels in like the music of Verdi. So we have so many different subsets that really kind of just determine, you know, what kind of repertoire you're going to sing, kind of the stereotypes assigned to your voice. Like I said, a coloratura soprano, we would expect to pop out tons of high notes, a lot of fast virtuosic singing. Think the Queen of the Night from the Magic Flute. That's a good example of a coloratura. There's also even things like dramatic coloratura. So a voice that has more heft and more cut, but also really high and agile. So there's so many different subsets. I think you get why, where I pleaded with you to not just say your choral range. It's just, it's bad. So there's a lot to think about. And people will kind of, sometimes it's not uncommon to change your fach as you get older. Plenty of mezzo-sopranos started off as sopranos, vice versa. This even happens professionally. Plenty of baritones can make a transition to like a Heldon tenor, like a dramatic Wagner tenor. So again, you know, when a young instrumentalist embarks on learning their instrument, they pretty much know they're going to play that instrument. You know, maybe you, if you're a flutist, you're going to also double in piccolo. Oboes have to also learn English horn. But the expectation is, I'm going to play this instrument. A lot of singers, when they're younger, have no idea really what their instrument is. So when you're younger, maybe you're a mezzo because you don't really have high notes. And then as you develop, maybe it's like, oh, you're actually really a high soprano. And you know, that's why finding a good teacher is important. Trusting your own instincts, but not letting your pride stand in the way is important. You know, I have a singer friend who is almost like a legit contralto, like a very low female voice. And when she started college, she was singing like light little high soprano stuff. That, I mean, that's a whole other topic, but that can be so detrimental, singing outside of your fach. So this is a very complicated topic. And again, hopefully you gain some respect for just how many other things we have to consider as singers. So now the fun part, now we're gonna actually listen to some singers, and we're gonna do that via YouTube right now. Okay, well, we will listen to a soprano, first of all. This is the American soprano, Leontine Price, who, a pretty good, just, you know, if you're gonna think of like a voice that shows off kind of the highlights of what a soprano can do, she's a good example. She's what we'd actually call a spinto soprano. And it's a bigger voice, slightly darker voice soprano that's going to really excel with music from maybe like the late 19th century, Verdi, some Puccini. But let's just give her a listen. Could listen to her all day. We don't have the time for that. So you can hear there's a richness and a fullness in her voice. There's a richness and fullness, but you hear, you know, she's going up to a high C, which for a voice like hers, that's a good high money note. Other sopranos, though, like those coloraturas, that's nothing for them. They can go 5, 6, 7 steps above that, okay? Now, let's listen to the next voice down, the mezzo-soprano, which, again, is more of a contemporary terminology. You don't really find the use of that term until maybe like the 19th century, give or take. So this is a very, very famous aria from Bizet's Carmen, sung by Agnes Baltza, who is a Greek mezzo who's still alive. She still sings a little bit. And you're gonna hear more darkness. You're gonna hear a little bit more of that husky, chesty, low kind of quality. But rest assured, if she had to sing the Puccini aria we just heard Leontine Price singing, she could sing it. It wouldn't necessarily be the most comfortable, but she could hit all the notes. She could do it. So we look at with voices something called tessitura. It's all well and good that it's a soprano role and you're a soprano, but tessitura means where does something sit? So if something sits a little high and you're not quite used to that, maybe that's not in a good tessitura for you. So she could sing, this woman could sing plenty of soprano stuff. She just wouldn't because the tessitura just sits too high. A mezzo like her will have a high note that she'll pop up to, but doesn't want to camp out up there. So let's give her a listen. She's one of my favorites. Sure you all recognize the tune. Now we are going to listen to a contralto, which is actually a very, very rare voice type. Again, why you don't use your choral voice type to say your voice type. Everyone says, oh, I'm an alto. No, it's rare that we actually find a real contralto. This is Marian Anderson, who was certainly groundbreaking with the civil rights movement. She was, I think, if not the first African-American to sing at the Metropolitan Opera, then she was like the second. She, you know, it's an older recording, but she was a contralto. And you're gonna hear, we're gonna listen to the second half of the song, Death and the Maiden by Schubert. She ends on a D below middle C, which is like the low middle of my voice. You're gonna hear what makes a voice like this special.
Thank you.
I hope you could hear that and just how low it was. And it almost starts to sound kind of androgynous. We are not used to hearing a female voice that low, creating such volume of sound. That's what makes the contralto very rare, is that they have to have that power below middle C that a lot of female singers don't have. Let's listen to a countertenor now. This is from one of my favorite operas, which is Akhenaten by Philip Glass. So like I mentioned, some more modern composers will use the countertenor for great effect, but a lot of the music they sing is just, you know, it's supposed to be replicating what we may have, something more similar to what we would have heard when the castratos were singing back in the 17th, 18th centuries. So this is just a little promo for the Metz Akhenaten, which is a wonderful production if you get to see it. So you can hear that's, it's a much higher, different tone than we are used to hearing with male singers. All male singers will at times sing a little bit in their falsetto, but not in the trained, cultivated, constant way that a countertenor does. So now we get to, I mean, now when people think opera singers, they probably think about this guy, or they at least think about tenors. So this is Luciano Pavarotti singing a little bit of an aria by Donizetti from Daughter of the Regiment. And as the video states, he's popping out repeated high Cs, which is, that's an octave above middle C. And that is a high note for a tenor. Some tenors can go even a little bit higher, but that's like a good money note. And the fact that he and plenty of other singers can just pop them out repeatedly is pretty impressive. The idea. So as we listen to other male voices, you're going to hear, of course, range and your physical instrument plays a part of your voice on your voice type, but also the color of your voice. You know, part of what makes him a tenor and so recognizable as a tenor is he has that really kind of ringy, the Italians would say squillo. So it's partly about color. And sometimes your color is at odds with your instrument. And that can make things difficult if you don't fit into like one little package. There are plenty of baritones that have almost that tenor color. That doesn't mean they should be singing tenor. You know, so there's all these kind of multi-layers to really finding your home as a singer. Now we're going to move into baritone. I'm very near and dear to this. So this is a great example of kind of Verdi baritone that I mentioned. So you kind of get the best of both worlds. You get a lot of thrust and ring like a tenor, but you get depth and lowness like a bass. And this is Piero Cappuccilli, who is an Italian baritone who really, really excelled with, you know, Verdi and similar composers. You're going to hear he doesn't sound like a tenor, even though he's singing quite high. So you can hear not a tenor, like doesn't have quite that brightness, but you're going to hear that it's certainly not as dark as a bass. And this is Gottlob Frick, who's a German bass, sang a lot of Wagner and stuff. And he's a good example of a more, we'd almost say like a basso profundo, like a very low bass. Here he is singing some Mozart, an aria from the Magic Flute. And you're going to hear that he ends on like a low E. So almost two octaves below middle C when he cadences. So you could hopefully hear a few of those extremely low notes. So his was a very like thunderous bass. Like that may, on a recording, that doesn't always sound super powerful, but when you hear a singer like this live in the opera house, even though maybe the volume of those low notes isn't huge, it is resonant and it carries. And that's where the acoustics of a hall are gonna kind of help the singer out some too. I'm going to play one more video just to touch on the idea of, just because, you know, one trains their voice in a quote unquote operatic way. I actually hate the term like, you know, like, oh, my teacher teaches a classical technique. Well, all trained singing stems from a classical place. We would not have the comprehensive study of singing like we have now without the formation of opera. So, And operatic singing, trained singing, it is built on the principles of how the human voice actually works. So I'm a big believer that training of that sort is only going to help you sing any other genre. You're going to make some changes, you know, just like a jazz pianist is going to maybe change a few things when they play, but the framework is still there. So as much as I am not a fan of like American Idol and those talent TV shows, this is a favorite video of mine. It's from Spain's Got Talent. And you're gonna hear the woman, who I think she won or was runner up. She starts singing very well an Offenbach aria from Tales of Hoffman, the Dahl song, with like all sorts of high notes. And then she goes into AC/DC's Highway to Hell. Rocking out. What I like about this video is her operatic singing is actually good. I'm not going to get on a soapbox right now, but on a lot of those talent shows, you'll hear, like the Charlotte Churches back in the day, no offense, anyone. You hear just kind of mediocre classical singing. This girl went, I mean, she went to a conservatory in Spain, like she is trained. So it is a great example of a coloratura soprano. And even though she starts singing like a rocker then a minute later, a lot of what allows her to do that is the training she undertook at conservatory. She knows what technique to rely on in those moments. She knows how to manipulate her sound to give the illusion of a rockier sound without hurting herself. So let's just watch this, because it's pretty darn exciting. And I don't usually fall for things like this. Allowed her to excel with some AC/DC is what allowed her to excel singing some operatic music. So, and they say opera singers aren't fun.
That's all I have, and that's my presentation officially. So, Alex, do you have questions for me? Or
I do have some questions. One thing I wanted to ask you to elaborate on are the misconceptions that body types have on your vocal type.
Oh, well, some of those misconceptions are not necessarily untrue. Look at the stringed instruments in the orchestra. Violin versus double bass. Different qualities, right? And while a double bass might, you know, the lower notes have less kind of cutting power, it's sonorous, it's very full. So there is some truth that the bigger the instrument, in some ways, the more sound you're gonna make. It doesn't mean that the body itself has to be big. Like, it's certainly a myth that it, you know, the soprano has to be the quote unquote fat lady. No. It's other things. Sometimes it's how broad your chest is, it's your rib cage. Height can play a role into it. A lot of it is neck and bone structure up here. That's what has a lot to do with it. If you look at the Australian soprano Joan Sutherland, if you've ever seen her, she had a very like broad jaw and like cheekbones. And that's what allowed her to sing. Even though she was a coloratura soprano, she had so much power and volume. So there is some truth with like the size of the singer, to some extent, is going to have an effect on the quality of the voice. You know, like a lot of basses tend to be quite tall and broad, and that length gives them more resonant space inside. So that might help them have more of that bassy quality. You know, it doesn't mean that all little like coloratura sopranos are like tiny, but there's usually, you know, there are some especially facial features that kind of correspond often to different voice types. So that it's both true and untrue. But then if you look at the, like, Wagnerian sopranos, they tend to be a little sturdier. They're a little taller. They're a little broader, at least. And it just has to be that way. Like, if you've got a bigger ribcage and stuff, you're going to be able to you know, usually project and propel your voice a little bit more in conjunction with stuff up here. So you will tend, you know, you tend to find that those voice types are just, you know, a little physically larger in some ways than other people. And I'm all for it because that's what allows us to get all of this great, exciting, authentic singing.
Another thing is, speaking of the voice types and the physicality of the different voice types and the package mm-hmm. that the singer is actually given to work with, this, to my understanding, is what determines what roles they are good at singing, what genres, what composers they're good at singing. And that's how, for example, an opera or a musical is cast.
Yes, and that's certainly the way it often is and kind of should be. There is definitely a trend, especially in opera, where they will cast someone versus on the looks and not necessarily on how appropriate it is for the voice. So I've heard stories of sopranos who are maybe on like the lighter end being cast to sing Strauss's Salome, just because, you know, the director deems them pretty enough to like take their clothes off on stage, even though they don't really have the voice to sing it. So you find a little bit of that in Hollywood too, where maybe someone is cast not on their acting ability, but on their look. Look will, I think, always be a little bit more important in musical theater than opera, but that trend has also been changing. Opera's gotten a lot more visual over the past couple of decades. That can get the singer into trouble because it's tempting to be given a role, but if it's not right for your voice, it can do some damage, or you won't do the role justice. But it's hard to say no. I mean, I get it. But yeah, that in many ways, that should dictate what they sing. Like, just because you're a soprano doesn't mean you can sing all the soprano roles. It's a lot more kind of niched.
So in your case, as a baritone, you also you have a niche vocal type. So what makes your specific vocal type, being a baritone, unique among singers and among roles?
Well, I mean, a baritone in and of itself, that's not a very unique. I mean, traits that have been said of my voice that make it a little bit more unique. I've been said it has a lot of brightness and cutting power, but there's a darkness to my voice that you don't always get. One of the reasons I sang a lot of, and I still do sing a lot of modern contemporary classical music, is because especially when I was younger, there wasn't quite a place for me. Like, again, I wasn't fully developed. People didn't know what to do with me. And so I was like, I'm just going to start singing really cool modern stuff where it doesn't matter what you sound like. So, you know, that it's cool to sing a brand new piece in that regard and have no expectation of what it's supposed to sound like. In music theater, a baritone voice, it lets you maybe do a little bit more like poppy kind of belty stuff if you need to. A real bass has more trouble doing that sometimes. So I think just overall what makes like a baritone like me, not just me, special is that there's that heft and that fullness like a bass. But there's a little bit more edge to the voice, or we'd say kind of a metallic quality that helps it cut over an orchestra. And we also, you know, we're a little less afraid to sing high notes like bass. So
we spoke a little bit in the trombone class about voice because the trombone was basically developed to imitate the voice and is the instrument that most resembles the human voice when it's played. And we've also spoken in some of our other classes about how we trade literature between instruments. And to my understanding, from my husband, who is a trombone player, actually, they will take voice repertoire and play it on the trombone. So he was curious about what etudes might be helpful to him in developing musicality that come from the voice repertoire and not from the instrumental repertoire.
All I will say about this is regarding like books of vocal exercises and vocalises. I know that a couple of the common kind of vocal exercise etudes, so to speak, from the 19th century, 18th century, are used with brass instruments like Panofka and maybe Lipkin. I think any of those, if they exist in like the brass world, if there was like a transcription for trombone, I think that's useful. But I mean, I think if any brass player wants to kind of see if the voice can help them more, maybe, you know, just common little arias that you can find like the tune to, and also just listening to how singers are achieving that legato, the smoothness, even though they're forming words. You instrumentalists, you don't have to make words. So that's one thing you don't have to worry about. I do know some brass and wind players that benefit from like basic voice lessons because you can get more in depth with how you're using your breath mechanism. I know there's certainly some good schools of brass training that are very much built on some fundamental vocal things, but you don't always find that. So instead of like looking for repertoire, I would actually encourage brass and wind players to maybe look at some articles or exercises with breathing for singers. And I think that can more positively influence, because it doesn't hurt to better manage your air on the inside before you're even managing it up here. So one of the links I have at the end here is one of the voice teachers who I respect most, but still current. His name is David Jones. He's in New York. And it's easy to remember his website, voiceteacher.com. He's got a lot of articles and writings and stuff. His book is great, A New Guide to like Old School Singing. And he has some good, you know, ideas and exercises for breathing and stuff that I think would help anyone who has to use their air. So I think that's actually more beneficial than repertoire.
We have a question about your practice routine.
I mean, that's very tailored to the singer. My own students, personally, I don't give them all just, this is your practice routine. It's certain exercises that highlight or train certain ideas, certain concepts, and doing those. So that depends on the singer. That's why finding a good teacher, a reliable, trustworthy teacher is important. Knowing your voice, like, you know, I know what I need to work on. At this point, it's not so much about practice with me. It's like just, I think of warming up as like, I'm calibrating my voice for the day. I'm checking, I'm seeing, you know, how's the high, how's the low? Where do I have to be mindful? You know, just finding your bearing. So I know what I need to do to kind of check those bases. Everyone is certainly different. I think finding whatever works for you, whatever you feel is helping, finding a regime, you have to be regimented with it, especially when you're younger. The good news is, one thing I liked when I was younger and moving from violin to voice is an instrumentalist, you're kind of expected at that level to be practicing 6, 7, 8 hours a day. Think about, you know, the pianists you've seen all night practicing. While singers need to often practice more, in my opinion, you can only do so much, or you'll physically get tired, especially when you're younger. It's like a workout. Like, certain exercises that we do are literally like the crunches for certain muscles in your voice. Well, you can't work out for 7 hours. So I think what's also valuable as a singer is I call it the like mental practice. It's like the studying of text, it's translating your music, it's listening, it's researching, it's sometimes just thinking through the singing and seeing how the muscle memory is still there. Even though you're not actually singing, if you put yourself in that mindset, you can practice, you know, the physicality of it. You can feel some of that without actually making sound. So it's really having the drive and the want to open up your practicing to be things other than I'm actively singing. So I think a lot of that is, I found it more interesting as a singer because it wasn't just 6 hours in the practice room. You know, even still, like if I'm memorizing music or something, I'll have the score on the couch with me. And when the commercials come on, if I'm watching TV, then I'll study, you know, a page of it. It's all of those little mental things that can be just as valuable in tandem with the active singing.
And the other thing I want to follow that up with is, how does your intelligence as an instrumentalist, how has that served you as an advantage moving instrumental playing to singing?
Ooh, I like that question. I think one inherent flaw with the way many singers start to be trained is it is hard to learn practice. First of all, if you don't really read music, if you're not very self-sufficient, just as a singer. So as a violinist and a pianist, I really learned how to practice. You all know this, like the pulling it apart, the slowing it down, the isolating, the problem solving. If you have a good level of musicianship, that helps you kind of figure out what the problems are. And then if you've been taught to practice, like a lot of instrumentalists are, it has always helped me like focus in on where I need to like work. A singer that doesn't know how to practice, they might just, you know, all they can do is like just sing their song. And then they'll know that maybe something's wrong, but they won't understand really how you embed it into yourself correctly. So I just think it's hard to learn how to practice when you're using an instrument like the voice that's so not tangible. It's hard to learn those skills of the repetition and things like that when it's not tangible. At least with an instrument, you get that start. And again, I mean, if a singer really has no like piano skills, if they can't play exercises on the piano, that can make things more difficult. Not impossible, but it's just, you know, it's using the musicianship and the problem solving to make the most of your practice time. We all know this, that you don't practice the stuff you're good at. You have to, you know, you spend 20 minutes on these two measures. Even though the previous page, you sing like a, you know, a star, you isolate that. And it's just hard if you haven't been groomed to do that, to figure those ideas out. Everybody, all singers should learn an instrument. That's my opinion.
One other thing that we have a question about is smoking and how smoking affects the voice.
I mean, to each their own. I've known people who, maybe they're sopranos, but they sing like alto at a church just because they, you know, for the money. So, you know, I've heard some stories where like their warm up is like smoke two cigarettes so they can like, go low. From what I know, it is, of course, it's not good, but I mean, okay, so smoking is, you know, likely like swell your vocal cords a little bit because of the heat and the, you know, the smoke and the particles, the voice is going to sense that as like a foreign substance and it's going to create some mucus. So yes, there's the idea that it, you know, can help with the low. However, so one of my favorite sopranos who was Swiss, Lisa Della Casa, she was singing like mid-20th century. She was a big old smoker. Like she literally, if you know the opera Ariadne auf Naxos by Strauss, she sang the title character and like she's on stage inside a cave for a chunk of the opera. And she literally like would have her cigarettes like preset in the cave so she could smoke during the performance. And she was singing this beautiful silvery Strauss and Mozart. So we won't watch it, but there's a video. This is part of an interview that she gives. She's singing like Puccini right beforehand. And then she comes and sits down and the guy starts interviewing her. And she's like, I'm sorry, I need a cigarette. And like, they bring a cigarette to her. And he asks her, and this is like from the 1950s or something like that, maybe 1960s. And he asks her like about the smoking. And she's like, I went to a doctor in Vienna and I said, tell me the truth about the smoking. And he says to me, the singing is more dangerous than the smoking. Now, don't tell the, you know, Attorney General that we're not gonna put that on the pack of cigarettes now. But I think what it shows is how adaptable singers are and how if your voice is very well trained and you're using it in a very efficient, correct, and honest way, your voice can handle a little bit more abuse and still get the job done. And again, if we go back to like an athlete, like a trained athlete, a trained marathon runner, maybe could be a little hungover and still run like a half marathon. I play this card sparingly, and I certainly don't say like, so go smoke a pack of cigarettes. But I try to tell some of my students who are serious about voice, but they also want to be like a teenager or a college student and have fun. I'll be like, you want to have a good time and like party once in a while, you better have a damn good technique, because it helps you get by. I mean, that's horrible to say, but it's true. If you are using it well, you can be a little less nice to it at times and still come out okay. Everyone has to, you know, do what they need to do. I mean, I literally in like downtown Chicago have like run into like world renowned singers, opera singers that are lighting up a cigarette on the street. Some people can't drink any caffeine or anything before they sing. I am going to the audition or rehearsal or practicing with my cup of coffee. Some people, you know, they can't eat dairy before they sing because of the phlegm. Some people, you know, if they have to sing, they can't drink alcohol for a week. Some people can, you know, have a couple glasses of wine at lunch and sing a beautiful performance in the evening. Like, so it's what I say about all of these things is just to each their own. But you get out of your body and your voice what you put into it. So if you're just filling it with tons of vices, at some point it will start showing in your voice. And in many ways it would show with any instrument, but there's a lot more layers to be worried about when it's your physical body. I am a pretty low-key singer. I can see my musicianship outside of me, and it's not just contained inside, like some singers. I think that's why they might come across as selfish or kind of distant. It's because all their focus is turned inward. I know that as I really became a better singer, as I really like solidified what vocal technique meant to me and having, you know, good teachers guide me, I became less worried about my voice because it's there. You know it. You trust in it. Trust is the hardest thing for a singer to learn. So I'm not too terribly finicky like some singers, no air conditioning or anything. I'm like, it's hot and I'm sweating. Turn the air on. There are two things I don't like to do if I have to like sing. I don't like to go out to a restaurant where it's crowded and I have to talk loudly. And while I don't have any real like food or drink problems with singing, but the only things I don't like to eat are chips or like crusty bread or sandwiches, because you know when that like chips like cut the roof of your mouth or scrape it up a little bit, that really bothers me because I feel it swelling and things feel different. Like how my tongue is functioning, I can just feel it more and it irritates me. So I really try not to eat like chips and guac if I have like a concert or something, because I don't want to deal with that. But just, you know, I think rest is the best thing for a singer. Like, get your 8 hours of sleep, use your voice well when you are not singing. You hear those people that they talk like this all the time. If you're a singer and you talk like that, like, you might as well just punch yourself in the throat, because it's ultimately going to just get in your way. But that's really, I like to be well rested. I don't want a lot of drama if I have to sing. That's going back to the psychology and how intertwined it is. My colleagues can tell if I have performing when I'm teaching. If I have performing coming up, like if I have to perform that night and I'm still teaching during the day, because I'm definitely just a little bit more reserved. It's that self-preservation. So that it's more about that stuff with me and not like rituals of I have to steam my voice, I have to eat honey and lemon. To each their own, but I don't need much of that.
Brad, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
This is actually our 10th masterclass. We did several percussion classes, two low brass classes, a woodwinds class, harp and piano. Our upcoming classes are violin, more percussion, and then we're going to have a session in September that's going to be about music education. So you can follow us on Facebook at Planning Logic Studio. All the event announcements are going there, as well as the video releases. And videos are also being released on the Planning Logic website and also on the YouTube channel.
Stay home for now, but if you come to the Chicago area, check out Lake Forest College. Thank you very much.
The kings of the earth are
I just, you know, will always be enamored with the human voice. For a nerd like me, there's always so many facets to explore, and so you can just keep digging deep. It's true of any music, but you can just keep digging deeper and deeper and deeper.